light's prediction. Simple models can predict better. This is the principle of Ockham's razor. So we need a way to assess a model to say some balance between good fit, because you don't want a bad fit. Really simple model, everything's a constant. It's not a good model, things change, you know. So you've got to get a balance between the two. Often you can describe these information criteria that measure the models in this way, that they'll have one component which is fit, one component which is simplicity, and add them together in some way. And then you choose the thing that's got the best combination of fit and simplicity. So this is the art of model selection. Now, there are many possibilities. Bayes has natural ways of doing, one of its greatest advantages is that it has some natural ways of doing that balance of simplicity and goodness of fit. Now, ideally, what you would like to get is something called the Bayes factor. And you can get this because of brilliant people like Jeff Rauter and Rich Mori in linear models, like anaerobic model regression. You can just get the Bayes factor package and it will give you a Bayes factor. And the Bayes factor, you choose the model with the best Bayes factor. Unfortunately, that is not possible with these models yet. It's an intractable integration we can't get to. But there are some prediction-related techniques. So these techniques are kind of like something called cross-validation. I describe what cross-validation, how it works, maybe this helps. These techniques rely on this idea that a good model predicts things. The way they work is you take some data, break it in half. You fit your model in half, and see how well it predicts the half it hasn't seen. Maybe you do this many times. The ideal way is where you develop your model on all the data but one point. And you do that for every, so if you have 1,000 data points, you must do 1,000 models to get them. This is very expensive, you're not going to, it's high computation. But there are approximations, and in this lesson we talk about one that is the current, so the one that you would see mostly in the old things like the JAGs and the wing bugs would be something called DIC, D-I-C, Deviance Information Criteria. I'm not going to make this very much. Alright, so DIC. It has some problems here. It tends to like too complex a model. The current one that everyone thinks is the best, and remember, none of these are ideal. Bayes factor is ideal. We can get it, we can't, is something called WAIC, which is the Watanabe Akinke information criteria, not the widely applicable information criteria, depending on who it was developed by a Japanese person whose name I just mangled. I don't know how to say it, my cousin. Anyway, but the widely applicable information criteria, and I have incorporated this into DMC just recently, so you can use this as a model selection. And the bottom line is that what you can do is you can sample a number of models. You can now choose the one that has the best WAIC. And that should do a reasonable job of trading off simplicity and goodness of fit. It is, I have to tell you, always hard work, because it's not too hard to choose. If the more complicated model is the truth, it's going to be easy, because the simple one will just get bad, and that will hurt. But if the simple one is the truth, the more complicated one, if it's what, this is what's called a nested model. So what you have is the better model is equal to the more complicated model is equal to the simple model, but it has some extras. So it must fit at least as well as the simple model, because it is the simple model plus something. So it always is going to fit at least as well. So now everything relies on the complexity of penalty. It must be just the right penalty for complexity. And so this is a very, very hard case. Now I show you some examples in this lesson where progressive and seeing DIC does okay, and there's a number of them. I give examples of a whole range of them. Quite through the WAIC, which does the best. And so, this is again imperfect. If I get anything across here, it is don't always doubt, always test, always think. My graduate students hate me because they come to me with results and WASC says this, and I say, maybe, but what about, let's look at the graphs, so what do they think? Let's think about this. Is it missing an important psychological phenomenon that I want it to work? Simple, but it's missing something that I know from other literature is true. No, it's not good enough. You know, and so you must think, you must plot this graph, you must. But this is good guidance, this is model selection, and we'll look at that a little bit in lesson 3.5. There's a software thing which is going on. Okay. Alright. I think I can probably just get all the lessons done, so I'll go on to the last one. Is it going to rain, explode? Yeah, or should we just finish the software? Okay. Alright, so now this is hierarchical models. These are in some way, this is the newest thing I've put into DMC, it's lesson 4. We literally only got it learned, we'll certainly have it working a couple of days ago. And we think we've discovered a new phenomenon, we're going to write a paper about it, aren't we? But we finally, before you should, I asked him to, I got it working for LNR, which is simple, it worked beautifully. And I said, Yishin, please, can you go and write the lessons for OBA and DDM? And he comes back and says, it doesn't work. Oh, I think, yeah, it doesn't work. And it turns out it doesn't work unless you have a complicated enough design. It's actually a design issue. It turns out you need some complexity in there. Anyway, now we know it works. But we have the LNR lesson, we don't have the other ones. But let me tell you that hierarchical models are very exciting and important for us in psychology because I'm starting to talk fast. I'm sorry. So now we don't fit each person separately. You are similar to each other. You're all people. It's crazy for me to think that if I know something about Dan, I don't know anything about me. Knowing something about Dan helps me. Dan is a certain height. It's unlikely that I'm going to be 100 times taller than Dan, or 100 times smaller. Right? So we know that people have similarities. We know that we're all drawn from some distribution that's, and we should use that. And the trick of hierarchical modeling is it actually uses it to solve another problem, which is the prior. How do I get a prior? The way the hierarchical model gets the prior is it kind of gets it from other people. So it says, what's your prior? Well, it's something related to everyone else. And so there's this process by which the model learns. It first looks at the data, then it looks at, it gets some parameters, and it looks at those parameters, and looks at everyone's parameters, and says, they come, you make some assumption, you say maybe you all come from a normal distribution, a normal variable Gaussian distribution. And then it goes back and forth, and it keeps updating the population distribution, and it updates the parameters, and the data. So the only invariants are kind of the priors of the population and the data, and it goes between these people. Now we're familiar with this in psychology, we would call this a random effects model, mixed model. So some of you may have statistically used these sorts of things. These sorts of models mathematically are very hard to solve, and so we have them solved in packages like, say, Elmer, NAR, or the general linear model. But for things like this, never get it. But Bayes turns out to be a very natural way of fitting these random effects models. In Bayes, you don't call them random effects models, but it's a similar way. So it turns out that you could do this Markov chain Monte Carlo sampling to naturally deal with these complicated models where we borrow information from each other. So now there's advantages in psychology. We always have data set with lots of people. Sometimes, in order to fit my models to one person, I need that person, I need to torture them, I need to make them do hundreds and thousands of trials. But what if I want to study small children? What if I want to study very old people actually really good? They will do thousands of trials, as long as you give them cups of tea. But there are many cases in which you just can't do lots of trials. So the hierarchical model can help you do it. And
it also just makes more sense. It makes, it's done properly, it just takes account. Remember, we always bring in prior knowledge we can. Prior knowledge we bring in here is that humans are similar to each other, the signs of right? Anyway, so how does this work? So we're in these sort of multi-parameter situations where we've got lots of, every subject has a bunch of parameters, we've got a bunch of things. We can end up with, say every person is a 10-parameter model, we have 100 people, that's 1,000 parameters we need to estimate. That's a lot of stuff to do. And there are these dependencies through the population distribution. So we'll call this, we'll talk about hyperparameters, the parameters of the population. What's the mean of the rate parameter across all the people in this group? This, of course, starts to allow us to do between subject groups. We can have group A and group B and have different population distributions for that. And the idea of the hierarchical model is it kind of balances between overfitting, where you fit each subject separately, this is too complicated, and underfitting, where you could just average everyone's data and then just fit the kind of average. That would be too simple, that wouldn't respect the way I did. So you then become somewhere between these two things. And this is what a hierarchical model will do. It will find a place between overfitting, describes my data very well, won't generalize to a new person. Underfitting doesn't describe the data I have. So you've got this sort of balance between them. That's what we're doing. So what you do is you assume your model parameters or data or independent samples from a population distribution with unknown parameters apply. So we'll have our betas and phis. And we can now talk about the joint posterior, the probability of the betas and the phis. We're always about that. I changed the equation to y, the data, so with data. We want to know what's the joint probability for all of this. That describes everything we know, betas and phis. Now, turns out we can factorize that in this way. So we can talk about the prior probability of the betas and phis and then the probability of the data given them. So we can factorize all of that there. But then we can take this thing, the prior. So now we've got that, that's the likelihood. We had that before, probability of data given parameters. Now times the probability of the joint prior. Then we can factorize that into the probability of the hyperparameters, the phis, and the probability of the betas given the phis. And turns out we can then sort of use this to sample. We can sample from this one, and then this one given that one, and that one. Right. I'll show you an algorithm for that in a minute. But I also want to talk about something. This is another important thing to getting Bayes. Something called posterior predictors. Now, how do I know whether my model fits well? I've sampled a model. Let's go back to the non-hierarchical case I should explain a bit earlier. Well, what I can do is I can take my model and I've got some parameters. You know, I've got a distribution of them. So I randomly pick a parameter set. And then I use that to sample some data from because I've got what's called a generative model that can generate data, right? These models can always make their own data. So I make some data. Then I sample another set of parameters, and I make some data. I do this again and again. And then I get a predicted distribution of data. And I can, so that's what you're saying is, this is what I know about the data. Here's my interval of certainty about data. And that takes into account all of your uncertainty. Not, so unlike, say, maximum likelihood, where you can say, here's my maximum likelihood estimate, I sample from that. You don't do that. You don't think it's just one, you think it's a range of things. You sample parameters, and then you take parameters and you sample data. So this is called the posterior predictor. You sample from the posterior, and you use it to predict data. Now, if you think about the hierarchical case, this is kind of interesting, because there's a second level of uncertainty here. You could want to predict just all the people you collected. I got 40 subjects, and I want to say, I want to predict just for those 40 people what's going on. But really, that's not what we must hear about, is it? We want to say about humans in general. If I've got 40 new people. So in the hierarchical model, you can do this. So this Y tilde here is the these future observations. you could first of all just get your visions of the old subjects with new data, like I just described. But you could also say, hey, I want to say what's going to happen for new subjects. So how do you do that? First of all, sample from the population distribution of new subjects. Because you've got these population distributions that tell you what people, how they distribute. So you first of all sample your files out of there, and then you use them to sample your data. So you've now got two levels of uncertainty built in. I want to generalize to new people. I want to generalize to new data. This is not only for people and data. Another, is anyone doing linguistic research? Words. So this is a big thing there. It's called the language is a fixed effect fallacy. I collect some data about these words, but I really want to say about all words. But really, my words are a random sample from all words. So I need to take into account the uncertainty of words. And they're a population, just like people. So you can do hierarchical random item effects, random subject effects, you can do all that in the general linear model, but you can do it also here. So you've got a couple of, now this can be a little disappointing, because you know, it's never nice to get a very wide prediction, like it tells you you know nothing. Of course, it's going to be much wider if you have subject uncertainty as well as it's the truth. Bayes is all about truly showing you not only what you know, but what you've done. And sometimes quite depressing when you have to go back and collect more data. Right, so let's look at this hierarchical sample. How does this work? So this is kind of pseudocode to, describe what goes on. So we've got to start off, we've got to pick our phis and our thetas for each subject, and we've got to make sure they're okay. That's one thing. When we start our Markov chain Monte Carlo, we can't start from parameters that make no sense, that absolutely they don't evaluate to have a likelihood. I should point out too that everything is numerical. Even in the ideal world, we should be able to sample the probability and see a standard normal distribution. If you take a number that's 100, you're not going to get a sensible probability density. It needs to be reasonable in some sense. So there are some bits here where you resample until you get a good start point, something that makes some sense. Now you're going to, again, this is like in our old algorithm, we want to get n Monte Carlo things, so we're going to do a big loop here. First of all, we're going to do the population step, the phi step. So we're going to get our new phi based on our old ones. That's the first Markov chain step. We get the posterior likelihood. We evaluate that. The sum of the stored likelihood. We get the posterior likelihood of the new thing and evaluate that. This was for a lecture in which we were talking about the computational. So every evaluate costs. Computation time. So there's you've got to evaluate and score some things. And then you do your metropolis step. So that's just like what I showed you before at the hyper level. So you sample at the hyper level, but you keep all your thetas the same. Now you've got new files. Now you sample down on the theta level. So we're going to want to go across our chains, we're going to want to update our thetas, find out what we had and what we got and do our metropolis step. And then we go back in. And the nice thing about this is it factorizes. We can go update this, back and forth, back and forth. And we'll end up getting our horizons. And so if we get to it in the final lesson, which may be tomorrow morning, I don't know, we'll have to work on getting a level of words tomorrow morning. If we can do that. Then, first of all, the software is set up so that you can automatically simulate a whole experiment. So it'll give you, you want 40 subjects, 250 observations of each subject, then it does it. We'll talk about priors for hierarchical models, because we already say there is you need a prior for the hypers. Talk about getting posteriors. The software could automatically fit a whole set of subjects as fixed effects, so just as individuals. So rather than having to do it one by one like we do today, it'll automatically go through a bit more. It turns out that's horribly efficient on parallel processes. It's always 100% efficient. So if you watch the cores on your machine, it'll get 100% and the fan will blow and it'll go really well. And then there's the random effects, the hierarchical model, and that just doesn't scale very well for modern cores. We'll go over 4 cores, my 60 cores, and 60 cores. This is all in LNR. I think that's probably where we'll get to. to. Pretty soon after I get back to Australia, I'll give you all the links that will have the hierarchical LPA and DDM lessons. That software is now, you know, publication grade stuff that you'll be able to, for a cutting edge work, you know how to use it. And I would encourage you to talk to me about it and try to support people and help them, you know, move things through and develop collaborations with the right communities. This software will continue to be developed. Yishin and I hope to have put in a facility to put in covariates within the next several months, if we're lucky. So we have a book chapter we have to write, model-based neuroscience. That could be relevant to some of you in neuroscience, so you can start putting in ERPs or some other stuff like that as covariates. And yes, we have further plans throughout the rest of the next year to keep developing this. Okay, thank you very much.
Last sentence for the doctor.